Our guest today is one of the most influential percussionists in Afro-Cuban jazz. He's been featured on albums by the Jazz Crusaders, Eddie Harris, Freddie Hubbard, Tito Puente, Mongo Santa Maria, among many others. He joined Cal Tjader's band in 1975 and remained with him as a featured soloist until his death in 1982. As a band leader, he's released over 20 albums, and in 1999, his album Latin Soul won the Grammy Award for Best Latin Album. Poncho Sanchez, welcome to the Prestige 70 podcast.
Thank you, Scott.
Well, I want to go back with you because so much of your path in your career in music has been unique. Born in Laredo, but your parents are from Mexico.
Right.
Tell me about when you came to Southern California.
I was 3.5 years old, I think they told me, when we came from Laredo. I have 11 brothers and sisters, 6 sisters and 4 brothers. And we're all born down south in Laredo, Texas, right next to the Rio Grande.
Yep.
My father was in the dry cleaning business. Yep. He had a little small cleaners. And he decided to move to Los Angeles because I think one of my uncles moved here first and said there was a lot of work and a lot of cleaners were opening up.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of work for my dad. So my dad decided to put us all in a black Plymouth. And we all loaded up like the Beverly Hillbillies and came on out. My father bought a house in Norwalk, California.
Which right, right.
Is, of course, a suburb of Los Angeles.
And
so for us, I think the way it all happened is we moved out to Los Angeles, Norwalk, and they discovered the television and the radio. You know what I mean? Because in Laredo, at that time, there was very little radio stuff. And anything you would get on the radio down in Laredo, Texas in the 50s would be Mexican music. It would be ranchera music, norteño music, or mariachi music, you know, like that, you know, from Mexico. When we got out here to California, my brothers too, but mostly my sisters, I have 6 sisters, and they caught the first wave of the mambo and cha-cha-cha music that came to Los Angeles by way of course, Cuba, Puerto Rico, New York City, even Mexico City, to Los Angeles.
Because you couldn't necessarily find that stuff on record anywhere.
They
had to be hearing it on the radio.
Not around here. You know, Scott, the way it happened, there's a gentleman that he passed away already by the name of Chico Sesma. Chico Sesma had the very first Afro-Cuban, what they call salsa music nowadays. Radio show on the radio at that time. He was the first guy and the only guy to play Afro-Cuban music or what they call salsa music today. And he would come out for 1 hour once a week. That was it.
And I think that was like on KOWL.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
And I was just a little boy,
but
my sisters would get in their room and move the rug out of the way or whatever, and they would wait for Chico Sesma's radio show to come on. As a matter of fact, later on in my record, Psychedelic Blues, I recorded his theme song. His theme song was a song called Con Sabor Latino. Con Sabor Latino means with Latin flavor. And I remember it would say, Con Sabor Latino, muy sinceramente, para sus vecinos y para usted, aquí estoy yo. Which means, for all you Latin lovers, I'm here for you to play Latin music. Huh. And then there's a part of the song where it slows down in tempo, because that was a mambo. The tempo I was singing is in a mambo tempo. Then it goes down to a cha-cha-cha, and it's going to a cha-cha now, and they would start singing in English. It says, I play your boleros and your merengues. I play all the cha-cha-chas and mambos for you. The swinging is band, the best in the land. And he said, I pleasure to be your host, da-da-da-da-da, and back to a mambo. So right when it would say, I pleasure to be your host, it's a pleasure to be your host, Chico Sesma would lower it down and say, hi, I'm Chico Sesma, and it's a pleasure to be your host.
That's awesome.
I'll never forget that. It was a little boy, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And my sister used to love that, you know?
Yeah.
Well, Chico Sesma was the first guy to play that type of music. He would play Cal Tjader and people like that, you know, Orquesta Aragon from Cuba. The charanga music from Cuba. Chico Sesma started the Latin holiday dances here in Los Angeles in the late 50s, early 60s. My sisters were barely old enough to go to those, so they used to go to the Latin holiday dances. and come home with the, they'd buy the records there from, you know, these different people, different artists. So they'd come home and the next morning they would put these records on all day long and dance. So I would watch my sisters dance the mambo and cha-cha-cha when I was a little boy.
Right. So that was when you were very young. Mm-hmm. As you were starting to get older, maybe getting into junior high school and into high school, what else were you hearing? What else did you hear?
Well, at that time is when the British invasion came in, right? Mm-hmm. You know, the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, like that. And also there was soul music, too. James Brown, Wilson Pickett, Otis Redding.
Yeah, great soul music.
Yeah, man. The best. Still my favorite
stuff.
And the Temptations and the Tops, you know, the Motown thing, you know. And then even a little past that into high school was the acid rock music, you know, the Who, the Cream, the
Led Zeppelin.
Iron Butterfly, all that stuff. Which I was not a big fan of, you know. And it was a little rough for me because my friends were, you know what I mean? Well, everybody in the neighborhood, you know, they knew all about that, you know, acid rock music.
Sure.
Because that was happening around that time, too. And I like black soul music is what I liked, you know. And I liked old doo-wop music and stuff. And, of course, Tito Puente and Cal Tjader. None of my friends knew what any of that was. They wanted just acid rock music.
Did you ever have to explain it to them?
Yeah, I sure did. And most of the time they'd say that's old people's music. Take that stuff off.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So I did have a few Jimi Hendrix records stashed for when my friends came over to smoke those funny little cigarettes and you know what I mean, like that.
I have no idea what you're talking
about.
If I understand correctly, percussion was not your first instrument.
No. At first, what happened is there was a gentleman that lived across the street from us. I must have been in like I don't know the fifth or sixth grade. And the gentleman across the street from us, his name was Benny Rodriguez. Benny lived across the street from us, and they had a rhythm and blues band. And that's when the Motown sound barely first came out, and they had a band called the Chevelles, when the Chevelle cars came out.
Yeah,
the Chevelles. And they played all this soul music, you know, and mostly a lot of Motown stuff. So I would sit in the driveway and watch them practice through the window. Benny played the guitar in the band, and so... that was the only thing available to me. I mean, I could feel this fire burning in my soul, man, that I wanted to dance with my sisters or I wanted to play an instrument or something, but we didn't have no money. When there's 11 kids, you ain't got no extra money in the house, okay? Yeah. Don't even ask. So Benny sold me an old acoustic guitar for 50 cents, but it was missing three strings. Later on, I bought the other three strings and he was trying to teach me just a couple of simple things. And I was doing that for a minute.
Yeah.
And then what happened is I got into junior high school right about then, and he was teaching two other guys down the street. There was three of us. He was teaching us how to play the guitar. Well, my dad got the big idea to move back to Laredo, and I think it could have been around 64 or 63 or something like that. Going back to Laredo, and we said, why? You know what I mean? We're from Los Angeles, you know what I mean? And a couple of my sisters got married real quick, so they wouldn't have to go back. Actually, they had a double wedding, I remember, and the next week we went to Laredo.
They both got married on the same day?
Yeah, because they had a double wedding because they didn't want to go to Laredo. And they were thinking about marriage, but that hurried them up, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it ends up, myself, my brother, a year and a half older than me, and then my sister, a year and a half older than him, us three had to go back. So we went back to Laredo, and they didn't know anything about soul music or well, not much, you know what I mean? They were into more of the traditional music in Texas, which is cool, you know, it's all good, but I wanted to learn James Brown or something, Ray Charles or something, you know? Well, long story short, I think I knew Honky Tonk on the guitar and What I Say and something real simple like that. I practiced those songs with three songs. I practiced them every day. A year later, we moved back to Norwalk, Los Angeles, and I thought it was a hot shot because I knew those songs real good, man, you know what I mean? And I went back to the neighborhood with the guys who were learning with me, and I knock on the door, and Ralph Vasquez, who has passed now, his sister answered the door. Poncho, what are you doing here? You know, because they knew I moved to Texas. We moved back. You moved back? All right. I said, is Ralphie here, man? You know, does he still have a guitar and all that? Is Benny still teaching him? He said, oh, he has an electric guitar with an amplifier now. What? You know, definitely got the three strings, you know? And he said, no, and they have a band down the street. Do you know Mike Dominguez? I go, Yeah, I remember Mike. He plays bass in the band, and they're practicing in his garage. I went over there like, what? You know, what did I miss out on?
Yeah.
I went there, and I walked in. They're like, Poncho, Poncho. They're rehearsing it, and I'm there, and I got my little beat-up guitar, and I'm starting to hide it now because they had brand new electric guitars with amplifiers, and they were sing. They were. They had a little repertoire of tunes. They had a band.
Yeah.
And drummer and all that. And I'm like, my eyes, my tongue's hanging out. You know, like, what's going on here? And I said, man, why did I go to Laredo? Look what I missed out on. Well, what happened is, I thought I was a hot shot guitar player, right? Mm. Well, Ralphie told me, Poncho, we don't need a guitar player. There was three guitar players in the band already, and they all played better than me, you know? Because Benny kept showing them, you know, and they kept...
Yeah, know, they progressed.
They progressed, and I didn't, you know what I mean? So he said, what we need is a singer. And I said, singer, huh? Mm. He said, there's the microphone, why don't you give it a shot? And I was a skinny... At one time, I was a skinny person. I was a skinny kid. And don't forget, I used to dance with my sisters.
Right.
They taught me all the latest dances. Well, I mean, I want to be in the band, right? So I got that microphone, and I put on the biggest show that I could think of. You know what I mean? I did the James Brown, and you know.
And You were hired.
I had no idea what I was doing. I was just doing it because I want to be part of this thing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I'm singing. And after the song was over, the guys in the band were staring at me, and they go, wow, Poncho, you sing great. I go, I do.
I'm in the band.
You got it. And they gave me a stack of 45s and said, we got a wedding this weekend. Learn
the songs.
And I'm like.
Well, so what was the repertoire? What were the songs?
I remember one for sure, Woolly Bully.
Woolly Bully.
Sam DeSham and the Pharaohs.
Yeah.
Out of Sight, James Brown, which later on I did an album called Out of Sight.
You know, right.
With Concord. And then at weddings, you have to sing slow tunes, you know, ballads or ballad. Well, they call oldie but goodies, right? Mm-hmm. Right. So, I mean, I had to learn That's All and For Your Love. Now, that's a classic. For Your Love, that was the wedding march for weddings.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that was a big wedding march for Your Love. You got to do it. Ed Townsend was the one version we liked. Hmm. So, you know, I learned all them tunes. I mean, well, sort of. You know, I was faking some of the words, you know what I mean? And I got out there, and the first gig I got to, the microphone's in front, of course, of the band, of the singer, right?
Sure.
And then I said, well, I don't want to be out. Put me over here with you guys. You know? So, no, Poncho, the singer always goes in the front. Oh, and plus, you got to make all the announcements for the way. I was scared of the microphone, you know? But you know what? By push and pull and all that,
right?
I became a vocalist. Yeah. You know what I mean?
But you were also a member of a band.
So, yeah, it was the Halos. That was it.
So your musical experience is now really beginning.
Yeah.
You know, that here you are singing with this band. Mm-hmm. How did you find your way to drum set?
The drum set. Yeah, what happened is, actually, I got a drum set first, a trap set.
Yep.
And I started learning to play a little jazz on there.
Uh-huh.
And then some soul music and whatever. And I used to be in a Tex-Mex band even, play Tex-Mex polkas and all that stuff. So I went through all that, you know what I mean?
Wow.
In the neighborhood. And then I joined another little band. I think it was called the Young Set was the name of the band. And they had some timbales there. So the first percussion instrument I learned to play was the timbales first. So I learned to play the timbales.
Yeah.
I think we were playing them backwards or something. We had them turn the wrong way, but we.
But here's the thing. I mean, this is the late 50s, early 60s.
60s, yeah.
Yeah, early 60s.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There's no workshops that you can go to. There's no
internet.
God knows there's no internet.
No YouTube.
You know, no YouTube, none of that.
Nothing.
So how, you obviously taught yourself in the main.
Yeah.
How'd you do it?
You know what I did? I had a lot of records from my sister's hand-me-downs, you know, brothers and sisters. And then by then I started buying my own records, you know. And there was pictures on the back of the albums with conga players like this or like this, you know. That, you know, and that's what I looked like, how he would hold his hand. And then I would listen to the sound of it. And you could tell that the conga player, there's a slap, pop, and they call it in Spanish seco, dry, pop. And then there's open tone, dum dum, pa, ta dum dum, pa, ta dum dum, pa. So I could see the hand like this in the picture, and I could see the other when I was open like that. So I would just try to do that, the pa and the dum dum. The hard part was to get the pa. The dum dum is pretty. You just kind of go, you go dum dum. You know,
yeah. It's kind of natural.
Hard. It's
to
not
get
too
that.
Hard.
Yeah.
But to get the pa, the slap.
Yeah.
You gotta position your hand. You gotta find the sweet spot on the drum. And I remember I tried for like 2 or 3 days. and it would sound like a thump, you know. It wouldn't pop, let me tell
you.
And I'm trying like crazy. And I mean, I said, God damn it, pop, that's it.
There it is.
Yeah. And so you could feel it in your hand when you get the pop. Mm-hmm. Pop, it's like, oh, now that's what they're doing. So that's how I started a step at a time, learning the slap and the pop. And then later on, I learned how to do the two-point shuffle, three-point shuffle, mambo, merengue, whatever. I learned all the different patterns because each Latin country has their traditional dance mm-hmm. and their traditional rhythm.
Yeah.
So all the different countries have. Yeah. So you got to learn all the different rhythms. Yeah.
But all of that stuff is incredibly intricate. It had to be a process for you of, you know, you put the needle down, you listen, take the needle up, you try it, put the needle down again.
Yeah.
That had to go on forever, seems.
I got to tell you a story. I'll tell you what happened. I was playing in the garage like that for about 2 or 3 weeks, and one of my sisters, my sister Gracie, you know, she knew all about the Latin mess. She used to go to the Latin holiday dances mm-hmm. all the time. Yeah. So she knew what was going on, and she'd come home from work or whatever, and she'd hear me in the garage, and she goes, you know, you're starting to sound pretty good. You know, like, it sounds pretty good coming out. The sound's coming out of the garage sound. Mm-hmm. You could tell it's a conga in there, you know what I mean? And she goes, you know what, I'm going to get a professional musician to come and give you a lesson. And she goes, there's a guy named Ray Medina. His name was Ray Medina. I seen him not too long ago. Well, maybe about 12 years ago. But Ray Medina, he had a little, Ray Medina and the Latin Four, I think was the name of his band. And he used to play at the Pasta House in East LA and some of the local gigs. Mm-hmm. Had a little Latin band. Well, anyway, she went to see Ray Medina and said, hey, I got a little brother that's learning to play congas. How much would you charge for a lesson or a couple of lessons? And I think he charged her $25. I didn't have no money.
Mm.
So my sister Gracie.
Your sister paid
she used
for
to.
It.
Beautician. She used to comb hair.
Uh-huh.
So she got a bunch of quarters together.
Yeah.
Anyway, it ends up that Ray Medina's coming to my mom's house, to my mom's garage. That's where I hang.
Yeah.
He pulls up. He lived in Los Angeles. We lived in Norwalk.
Mm-hmm.
And he went and he said, give me a hand. I think he had crutches. He had a crutch. He had some kind of leg problem or something. And I said, oh, sure. You know, I'm a young kid, strong, ready to go. I pulled out the congas out of his. He had a VW bus, you know.
Love days. That.
And I pulled a conga out of there, and I told, wow, that's a gumbop. You know, gumbop was a company that makes congas. They're still around making congas, which later on they made congas for me, the Poncho Sanchez model.
Yeah.
That's another story. But anyway, I'm pulling these drums, and I go, oh, that's the voodoo model. And I mean, because I used to see it in the Downbeat magazine.
Sure.
I would see the advertisements.
Ads. Yeah, yeah.
The ads.
Yeah.
So I knew what every drum looked like.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's a new one, or that's the old one, you know. Well, anyway, he comes and I go, man, these are beautiful congas. He goes, that's the best conga money can buy. You know, I said, I know that. You know, I wish I had them. And I went in the garage and I had some little striped congas from Mexico, and they cost me $67 a piece. And they were brand new.
Yeah.
But anyway, they weren't too good. Anyway, the guy came in the garage. He goes, you know, I'm kind of running late, so we better hurry up. I go, geez, you know. And he said, first of all, let me see you play just so I can see where you're at and I can see where to go with you.
Yeah.
And he goes, put on the record and play the record. I said, cool. I had my favorite Cal Tjader record on it. Put the needle on it. I'm doing my little thing, you know.
Uh-huh.
And then after, bum, bum, and then take it off the thing. I sit there and he's staring at me. I'm going, uh-oh. Maybe I'm like totally wrong here, you know. He goes, hey, man, how did you do that little move with your left hand? I said, what? I demonstrate, you mean this? He goes, yeah, man, that's nice, man, that's nice. I go, oh, thanks. And he goes, how long have you been playing? About 5 or 6 years? I go, 5 or 6 years? 3 weeks.
Ah!
He goes, well, how did you learn? Like, you asked me, how did you learn? I go, I don't know, looked at the back of the albums and got the pop and the slap, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but some of that, I mean, some of that had to be kind of in your DNA.
I think so.
You know,
I mean, I really.
I mean, just watching you here, this stuff just comes out of, you know, the rhythm, the sense of rhythm.
I think
just
that,
comes out of.
There's
you.
Something in it, way back in there that we don't all know about. You
right.
Know what I mean?
Right.
But you know, it felt very natural to me.
Yeah.
As well as singing in that band and dancing like James Brown. I mean, that came pretty natural to me.
Right.
That's why I did it. Right.
Right. Right.
I mean, and I got accepted. You know.
Yeah.
And same with the conga. Felt very natural. It actually felt good on my hands when I hit mm-hmm. the drum.
Yeah.
It actually felt right. You know what I'm saying? So it fit like a glove, you know?
Uh-huh.
And after that, the guy told me, and then there was a drum set there. And he goes, don't tell me you play those too. And I go, well, actually, I play those better than these. So I don't want to hear that.
Yeah.
You mentioned that you were listening. You were already at that point listening to Cal Tjader.
Oh, yeah. Ever since I was a little boy, because my brother and sisters had the records.
Yeah. What is it about that music that so moved you at such an early age?
Man, you know, I think it's just the sound of the vibes and the conga and the timbales. Mm. It's mellow, smooth, rich sounding, but with a percussion there, it's tasabroso. In English, that means it's very flavorful. Mm. You could taste the flavor or the rhythm. Right away, you just want to groove, you know? Yeah. And then with the vibes, but how mellow. And then the way Cal played, he played vibes smoother and sweeter than anybody I know. Yeah. The only one that sounded like Cal Tjader a little bit was Milk Jackson Bags.
Yes.
But he played jazz.
Yes.
You know? Cal played Latin jazz, you know what I mean? And so all that put together, I really was really impressed with that. It just felt right to me. And then I was learning about jazz at the time, you know, about my first John Coltrane record when I was in eighth grade or something. And I learned about the progressive jazz and stuff. And then with the Latin rhythms, you cross those two things together, you got Latin jazz.
Yeah.
I think it has the best of both worlds because it has the melody, the harmony, the sophistication of jazz or American standards or like that with the flavor of the Latin rhythms and the Latin dancing. You cross those two things together, you get Latin jazz.
Yeah. Right? Just to run the clock back just a little bit, you were talking about, you know, learning to play in the garage, and you would go out and play in a park in Santa Monica.
Griffith Park.
In Los Angeles.
Yeah, right off the 5. Yeah.
Right, right. Yeah.
I guess I was maybe almost out of high school. Mm-hmm. And so somebody told us, you know, there's conga players that play every Sunday at Griffith Park, which they still do today, you know. So I said, wow, oh, Griffith Park, that's where the merry-go-round is and all that. Uh-huh. Yeah, that over there. So we went down to 5 and got off there, Los Feliz or whatever.
Uh-huh. Yep.
And we went over there. It was myself and Ramon Banda, who has passed away. We just lost him about a month ago. Ramon, we went to Griffith Park. Ramon took timbales and I took congas. Well, anyway, we got to the park, and it's a Sunday afternoon, and it's a beautiful day, big, huge trees, beautiful park, right? All kinds of people. And there was a bunch of guys underneath a tree, and they're all drinking and smoking them cigarettes and stuff, you know what I mean? And we're all hanging, and they're playing, but everybody's got they got trash cans and just anything they
plastic
can beat
buckets
on. You know, and they're just beating on it, and we did that for about 40 minutes, and it's just a bunch of noise is what it is.
Yeah.
And after a while we said, oh man, you know, this ain't cool, man. You know, this is people are just getting high and acting up is all they're doing. This is craziness, you know. And some guy tapped me on the shoulder and said, hey man, you sound pretty good, because I guess, you know, you people paying attention to what you're doing, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm just trying to catch a groove, you know. Well, he said, you know, you should go up there with a good conga players play. And I go, up where? You know, up there by the merry-go-round. You know the merry-go-round? I go, yeah, up there on the hill. He go, yeah, they're right next to the merry-go-round. There's a piece of cement there where I think they had a picnic table, and they moved the picnic table, so that's where they could play. To play on the carpet or to play on the grass, it eats the sound of the conga.
Right.
You put on some wood or...
Sound bounces around.
Yeah, it's better.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So he goes, yeah, they're up there, but they're the good... They're Cubans and Puerto Ricans up there, and they play really good. And I told Ramon, just go, man, you know. Let's go up there. So we start going up there, and we put our drums down, and we're watching the circle, right? And there's about 10 guys playing. And I go, wow, yeah, they sound good, man. And they're singing the rumba, you know. Oh, yeah, mi guaguanco, oh, yeah, para osa. And we're going, yeah, man, this is shit, man. This is it, baby. And so we're watching all the cats play, you know. And people are hanging around, drinking beers and whatnot, you know. And then all of a sudden, I tapped a guy on the shoulder. You know, I could tell he was the main guy, you know. And because he was soloing, he playing the quinto. Quinto's a smaller conga, and it's higher pitch.
Mm.
It's a talking drum. It's a solo drum. Everybody's playing like basic patterns, and this guy talks, you know, solo. And so I'm watching the guy play the quinto, and I said, wow, he plays good, you know. So we're checking him out, and I tapped him on the shoulder. I said, hey, man, could I sit in? And he looked at me like that, and he's playing. And he said, ¿tú eres cubano? And I said, no. Yeah, are you Cuban? I said, no. ¿Tú eres puertorriqueño? I said, no. Are you Puerto Rican? No. He said, what are you? I said, I'm a Chicano. Tejano. You know? I'm a Texan, man.
Yeah.
And he looked at me, he goes, Chicano no puede tocar la conga. Means Mexicans can't play the conga. Mexicans can't play the conga. And they keep playing. Blah, 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 and go, I go, how do you know? You haven't heard me, you know? Like, I got mad, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And I said, and then Ramon said, what did he say? I go, oh, man, he won't let me sit. And he said Mexicans can't play congas, man. And Ramon just, we're just looking at him now. And then all of a sudden he got up to go get a beer or go shake somebody's hand or something. He got up from it. You could tell him he walked across the circle there. So I jumped on there. The guy looked back like that. And he said, you know, and he let me play. I'm like, yeah. I played, yeah, I don't know, 4 or 5 minutes, whatever. And after they finished that little rumba, he told me, he was telling me in Spanish, he goes, wow, man, you sound great. He goes, your father's got to be a Cuban. I said, no, I told you. Okay, your mother's Puerto Rican, right? And I said, no, they're from Mexico. And he goes, how you learn to play like that? I said, I don't know. I like it. I have a lot of records at home of Mongo Santa Maria and Cal Tjader. And he goes, man, you sound good. Stay with us, man, play. And that's how I had to break my way in there.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Right. I mean, there was a sort of defined hierarchy of what was going, even in the park.
Yeah, you're not going to play if you don't play good. Man.
Yeah, yeah.
They're going to get you out real quick.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And they're not like really nice guys and to tap you on the shoulder. Could you please move? You know?
Yeah.
They're going to grab you and say, get the hell out of here. You know what I mean? They're not going to play with you. Yeah.
How often did you go back?
We didn't really go that much, but we went like maybe, you know, 3 or 4 times a year.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? You know, and then after a while, we started getting gigs and trying to put little bands together.
Sure.
We were kind of starting to do our thing, you know.
Yeah. You mentioned Mongo Santa Maria.
Yeah.
And he would become very important to your career. And I read that you would go see him, I think, at the Lighthouse.
Yeah, Hermosa.
In Hermosa. Beach. What did you learn by going to see him so early on?
Well, you know, I was in high school, you know, it was hard to get a ride to go that far out from Norwalk to
over there. That's a long way.
It's about 20-some miles or something.
Yeah.
And so the cats in the neighborhood who had low riders, I would tell them, hey, man, take me to Hermosa Beach. They'd go, Hermosa Beach? What do you want to go there for? I'd tell them, I'll put 50 cents of gas if you take me. That's a lot of gas.
That's a lot of gas.
Yeah, 50 cents of gas. I'd see Mongo play. I see Mongo, Santa Bunny's band play there, Cal Tjader's band. The Jazz Crusaders, I seen all of them play there. So that was a big deal to me. So we'd sit and watch Mongo play. Well, actually, I'd get there like at least an hour early just to stare at his congas because they'd be right in front of me. We'd sit in the front row and I would just stare at his congas like, wow, you know, how come I don't have something like that? And I would try to find out the difference between my conga and his. You know, maybe it's all in that conga that gives him that sound.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you're thinking of everything,
sure.
Right? So I'm checking. For an hour, I would look at his congas. Of course, you know, you respect, so you would never touch, you
right,
know?
Right.
And then when he'd walk out to come and sit out, I mean, I'd almost pass out. I mean, that's almost too much. Now he's behind the conga, the man, you know?
Yeah.
And then he'd start playing it. Oh, man, I was in heaven, you know?
Yeah.
So I would watch the way he moved and the way he tilted the drum, and I just watched everything he did, the great Mongo Santa Maria.
Yeah.
One of my partners said, won't you go talk to him and ask him about the conga, you know? So I was, you know, scared, and I respected the man very much.
Mm.
And I knew he didn't speak really good English because he was from Cuba. So I went up to the bar because Mongo was sitting at the bar, and I was just a boy, like in high school. And I said, of course, everything in Spanish. I told him, excuse me, maestro, maestro. Excuse me, maestro is a teacher, you know?
Yeah.
Excuse me, maestro. My name is Poncho, and I'm learning to play the conga. And I said, I want to ask you a question. Is this the right way to play the mambo pattern? And on the bar... Yeah, I went to do my little thing, and he looking like this, you know, he had a little drink in his hand, looking at me like that, and then I stopped and I go, is that right, maestro? You know, is that right, teacher? And he goes, más o menos, which means more or less. and then I waited for maybe some for him to say something else.
Right.
That was it.
That was it.
Más o menos, and then he went back to his. That was it. Now there's a wall here, you know? Like, you don't want to talk to me no more. And I went, thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
And I walked away, and my partner said, what did he say? I go, más o menos. More or less. And it's funny, many years later, when I got the gig with Cal Tjader, because he used to play with Cal Tjader before me.
Yes,
Then he seen me play, and he goes, ah, you're the kid that...
He said, you can play. He did make the connection.
Yeah, he said, you can play, man.
Wow.
And then not only that, Mongo Santa Maria came to be one of my best friends.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I have a son named Mongo. Mm. I named my first son after Mongo.
Yeah.
And when we went to see Mongo play, my wife Stella was pregnant with with the baby.
Yeah.
In those days, you didn't know if it was going to be a boy or a girl. She had the baby here. And I told Mongo when I would see him play when he came off the stage, Mongo, could you rub my wife's stomach? Because if it's a boy, we're going to call him Mongo, you know?
Mm.
And he goes, oh, yeah, yeah. So he's rubbing Stella's stomach for good luck. And, of course, he came out a boy, so we named him Mongo. His name's Xavier Mongo Sanchez. And then when they're little, you call him Monguito, you know? They're little, because they're little Mongo.
Right.
And so I would take him pictures of Monguito when he was little, when he was a baby. And so he would always tell me, Poncho, give the baby a kiss for me, you know, because, you know, he's from New York and we're from LA.
Sure.
Give the baby a kiss when you get home for me. Oh, yeah, maestro, I will. And, like, you know, 20 years go by, we became good friends. Poncho, give the baby a kiss for me. Mongo, he's 23 years old.
You described his playing as heavy.
Yeah.
What does heavy mean to you in terms of his playing?
Heavy hitter, man. It's like a heavyweight champion.
Really?
They're not just going like this. They're going with all their
haymakers.
Oh, man. Like, if you get hit, you're going to feel it. You know what I mean?
Hmm.
Well, he was like the heavyweight champion of congas. You know what I mean? He plays like this, you know, like this, like that, you know? Bah, bah, bah. And if you sit close enough, you could feel the wind from his arms. Like, damn, this guy's hitting the drum.
Yeah.
He's not going, you know, this kind of thing. He's not doing that. You could feel it. You're like, wow, you could feel the ground vibrating a little bit. Like, man, that guy's kicking ass.
You know?
So you pay attention, you know?
Sure.
I mean, this is right in front of you.
Yeah.
So you feel everything. It's like, wow, do you hear that sound he has?
Mm.
I mean, it's just heavy and strong. Bah, bah, gung, gung, da, bah, dun, bah, dun. Like, man, it almost sounds like gunshots, you know?
Yeah.
Like, wow, man, how does he get that big sound?
Mm-hmm.
So I worked on that for a long time to get that sound. You know?
Yeah, we talked briefly about Cal Tjader and you know, I really kind of want to get into a little bit of your time with him. Now I know it's a fairly well told story about your being introduced to him, but I know you had gone to see him at Concerts by the Sea.
Right.
And there was some guy there. Tell that story.
Oh, yeah. The gentleman who has also passed away now, Ernie Stills.
Mm-hmm.
And the way that happened, I was playing with that band Sabor.
Yeah.
And now I'm married, you know, to Stella, and I was working in a foundry, you know, during the week. Just working, you know, and then playing on the weekends with Sabor.
Mm.
And there was a local club in Pico Rivera, which is kind of close to where I live now. And there was a club there. And it was predominantly a Latin American club. You know what I mean? It was called the Latin American Press Club. That's what it was called.
Huh.
And they had a couple of bands, one Sabor in one room and another band in another room. Anyway, it used to get really packed and people would come in. I would say, you know, 90% Latino people in there, you know what I mean? And then in walks this white guy and he's wearing a hat with a little feather sticking out, I remember. And I'm playing up there and this white guy walks on, I think like, wow, he sticks out like a sore thumb, you know what I mean? But he was, whatever, it's a safe enough place. He'll be all right. So he went to the bar, of course, you know, went straight to the bar. And we're playing that bum, bum, our set ended. We'd be right back in 15 minutes. So, of course, I'm going to the bar now, right? So my turn to go to the bar on my break. And it ends up, I was right next to this guy who walked in. And he says, hey, man, you sound great. And I feel like saying, how do you know?
Who are you?
Yeah, you know?
Yeah.
And then he said, no, man, you really sound great, man. You want a drink? And I'm going, you buying, I'm drinking, you know? So he bought me a drink, you know? I thought, that was nice. And my name's Ernie and all that. He goes, and I'm a good friend of Cal Tjader's. And I went like, you know? To myself, I'm thinking, I got my drink. I said, hey, Ernie, thank you for the drink. And don't forget to tell your friend Cal Tjader about me, you know what I mean? And he goes, oh, yeah, I'm going to tell him. You know, I went back to the stage with the guys in the band, and they're just hanging, doing their thing. And I said, hey, you see that guy over there with the hat on? He goes, you mean the white guy that walked in with the hat? I said, yeah. He said, these guys in the band said, I said, see, I told him, he just told me he's a good friend of Cal Tjader's, and all the guys in the band said, yeah, right, get out of here. You know, in Spanish, they say mentiroso, which means that liar. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Eh, mentiroso, you know. I said, well, that's what he said, whatever. And we played, and that went on. 2 weeks went by. Cal Tjader came to town at Hard Rumsey's Concerts by the Sea. Mm-hmm. Downstairs, underneath the pier, right?
Right.
So I get there with my wife Stella and my friend Candy Martinez, and we start going down to go, you know, pay our money to get in to see Cal Tjader play. We're at the top of the stairs, and down at the box office, right at the bottom of the stairs, is Cal Tjader and this guy Ernie, face to face talking to each other, and I stopped dead in my tracks. And I went, and he looked at me and goes, "Cal, that's him, Poncho Sanchez," and I froze, man. And then they said, "Who's that guy?" I go, "Remember that guy I told you was lying, that he said he knew Cal Tjader?" I said, "That's the guy, that's him, the guy from Pico Rivera." And he goes, "Cal, that's him." I went down the stairs, and now I'm going, I'm shaking now. You know, I mean, this guy wasn't lying, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And he's Cal, Poncho, and then Cal Tjader. I didn't know at the time, but Cal was letting guys sit in because he was going to break up his band and put a new band together.
Mm.
And he already knew guys around town that were interested.
Sure.
And he just went by this guy's word. This guy named Poncho Sanchez plays pretty good.
Yeah.
Well, he says, "Man, my friend Ernie here says you play pretty good." I said, well, thank you, man. I'm looking at Ernie. Man, thank you, you know? Mm. And he said, "You want to sit in?" And I go, "When?" He goes, "Tonight." And I said, "Wow." And we sat down. I watched him play. A guy named Michael Smith was playing conga with him,
uh-huh.
A guy from Chicago, yeah. Who's also passed away now, who I knew Michael very well later on in life also. Anyway, he called me up on stage. And I went over there, and I sat in. I was going to play one song, right? I took a solo. The crowd reacted. I mean, this is the greatest thing that could ever happen to me. Just one song, and I could live the rest of my life bragging about that. You know what I'm saying? The song was over, and I went to tell Cal Tjader, "Thank you for letting me sit in."
Yeah.
And he pushed my shoulder down like that. He goes, "Stay with us the rest of the set." And I went like, Anyway, long story short, I played four more tunes with him. He said, "Give me your name and your number and all that, you know. Maybe when I come to Los Angeles, I could use you." I said, "Oh, that would be great. Thank you, Mr. Tjader," you know? And so I was living at my mother's house, and I was gone, and the phone rang, and I guess my mother answered. She speaks broken English. And my mother answered and talked to Cal Tjader. And I was out doing errands or whatever. I came back home about an hour later, and my mom said, "Oh," in Spanish, she told me, "somebody called for me." I go, "Who, Mom? You know, who called?"
Yeah.
She goes, "I wrote the number down." I said, who is it?" And she said, "Alligator." And I said, "Alligator? Cal Tjader, Alligator."
Alligator, yeah.
Yeah, and she didn't speak very good English. So, so she said, "Oh, uno que se llama Alligator, algo así," you know, something like Alligator. And I go, "Mom, who was it?" You know what I mean? She said, "Well, the number's there." I said, "Mom, was it Cal Tjader?" She goes, "Eso, you know, that's it, that's it." I called him, of course, and he said, "Hey, man, I want to use you. New Year's Eve at the Coconut Grove at the Ambassador Hotel, New Year's Eve 1975.
Which, by the way, that's a big gig.
Big time, man.
That's a big gig.
I only see that on TV where movie stars used to go to.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I he said, "You know where the Ambassador Hotel is?" The Coconut Grove. I think they were calling it concerts at the Grove by then, you
mm-hmm,
know?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, "Well, yeah, I see it on TV. You know what I mean? I don't know where it's at." I said, "But no, I'll get there." And I hung up the phone, and I was like, "I can't believe this, you know?" He hired me to do that New Year's Eve, and then four nights down in San Diego.
Hmm.
And that's it. That's what he hired me for a week. And I told my dad in Spanish, "Hey, Dad, do you know where the Century Plaza Hotel, Ambassador Hotel is on Wilshire Boulevard?"
Yeah.
And my dad said, "Ooh," like that. He goes, "Ooh." He goes, "What do you want to know that for?" And I go, "Dad, I'm going to play there." And he goes, "You're going to play there?" No, he goes, "No. Only movie stars go there, and only rich people go there. You have no business there." I said, "Dad, do you know where it's at?" He goes, "Pa allá, por la Wilshire, pa allá." He goes, "That means far away over there, Wilshire somewhere." Anyway, I finally got to the gig, and I played. And after the first set with Cal Tjader, Mary took me in a little dressing room about this size, small room, and took me in there and said, "Poncho, man, you really sound great. You sound like a young Mongo Santa Maria," who was my hero.
Oh.
And said, "You got the gig." And I told him, "Oh, I have the gig for tonight and 4 days in San
right,
Diego."
Right, I'm good for tonight.
No.
Yeah.
You're in the band. So I could not believe it, man. And that was New Year's Eve, 1975.
Was that your ticket out of the foundry?
Absolutely. Well, it's funny. I was laid off from that foundry.
Oh.
And my unemployment was getting real thin by then. I had been collecting employment for about 4 months already.
Yeah.
And playing little gigs from side to side, time to time. So things were getting real thin.
Yeah.
And they hadn't called me back. They shut the foundry down. That's what
right.
they did.
Right.
So I was needing a job.
Yeah. You know what I mean? But I mean, think about so some of the soloists that have worked with Cal Tjader over the years, Mongo being one, Willie Bobo, Armando Peraza, pianist Lonnie Hewitt.
Oh, my Lonnie was a good friend of mine, man.
Vince Guaraldi, Chick Corea. So all of a sudden now you're the featured soloist.
Man, I'm doing this.
Did some of this run through your mind as you're, you know, as you were beginning with him that you were filling a pretty significant chair, if you will.
Those are they're still my heroes today. All those guys you mentioned, they're my heroes. And I'm blessed that I got to know them all. I actually played with them or got to know them very well.
Yeah.
And I was dead serious of being Cal Jader's conga drummer. Whatever it took, I'm going to learn how to do everything the right way. As a matter of fact, I remember I was in this band for 7.5 years.
Yeah.
And I played one night I was in the band for about a year and a half, or we played for many gigs already, and I made a mistake on stage, I missed a break. And I got mad at myself. I went, shit, you know, on stage. And Cal went like this, great, you're human. Remember he told me that. I went, what?
Yeah.
He goes, you never make mistakes. Thank God you finally made one. Yeah. Now I know you're human. Yeah. I said, no, but it's bad I made a mistake. That's how serious I was.
Yeah, tell me about Cal Tjader. And about, I mean, you said you were with him for 7.5 years.
Yeah.
And really, this was very much the beginning, if you will, of what would really be your career.
Yeah.
What did you learn from him?
Well, you know, he didn't sit me down like a music teacher and say, here's how you do it and all that. It was just more like just hanging out with him. That's how you learn, you know what I mean? So I was lucky because I had all the early Cal Tjader records and I knew all the songs and all the breaks. So he could call off a tune and I knew it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or, you know, 90% of it, you know what I mean? So I was lucky there because I studied his music before I got in his band. So that was a plus for me.
Yeah.
And then I learned a lot from Cal just being on the road, basically. I was on the road with him for 7.5 years, and I was with him when he died. I seen him die, you know? And we were in Manila in the Philippines when that happened. But just by being around him every day, you know, sometimes I'd go to his room on the road, and he'd be on the line with a club owner or a promoter, and he'd be yelling all upset, and like, you know, I'd go, oh, man, I wonder if Cal's okay. And,
yeah.
And I didn't know nothing about the business in those days.
Right.
I'm just taking care of Cal Jeter's conga chair. And Cal says, hung up the phone one time and he said, Poncho, one day you're going to know what I'm going through right now. He goes, you're going to have your own band one day and you're going to go through a day like I'm going through. He goes, I need me a scotch and water right now to take the edge off. And I didn't even know what take the edge off meant at that time. I drank beer and that was about it, but I didn't know what take the edge off means. I hadn't had that much experience in life to know what that meant.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, after he'd passed and about 3 years into me being a leader, I had a day just like that. I said, that's what he means, take the edge off.
But what a great apprenticeship to, you know, to kind of get a sense of what it meant to run a band.
Well,
and the kind of responsibility you had.
Well, you know, Scott, with Cal, you know, the one great thing he had a knack for picking out like a standard, just an American standard, and do it as a mambo or a cha-cha or a bolero. He would find a way to adapt it to the rhythms, you know what I mean? And he did that a lot. And so I started seeing the way he did that. Like, he would take just some standards, you know, he'd pick a standard, you know, Mrs. Jones or what's it called, any of those type of tunes, you know, standards. And he would adapt it to a mambo or a cha-cha. And I said, man, that actually lends itself nicely.
Yeah.
It's got a nice smooth groove to it, you know. You know, he had some great ideas that.
And did you guys ever talk about, you know, because he was of Northern European descent. You know, it's like, where did that, in a guy like that, you wonder where that groove came from?
Well, Cal Tjader, a lot of people don't know the story. Cal Tjader is Swedish descent.
Swede. Right.
And he was born in St. Louis in a vaudeville family. He was a tap dancer and then became a drummer. A lot of people don't know. Cal Tjader was the first drummer with Dave Brubeck's band before Joe Murillo and all that. Cal was the drummer with Dave Brubeck's band first. And that's where Cal met Armando Peraza. Well, he met, then he went to George Shearing's band playing vibes with George Shearing. And that's where he met Armando Peraza, the great Cuban conga drummer. And that's what started making the things go for him. Cal was a tap dancer. So Cal could dance the mambo, the cha-cha-cha. He was a good dancer. For a white boy, he could dance. You know, as a matter of fact, one time we were at Howard Rooms, this concert by the sea.
Yeah.
And I was playing there with Cal Tjader. And in walks Buddy Ebsen from the
Beverly Hillbillies.
Yeah. Remember big, tall Buddy, Buddy Ebsen? Jed Clampett.
Yes. Right? That was the role. So,
and I would always watch the Beverly Hillbillies in those days. Cal, they waved to each other and go, wow, does Cal know Jed Clampett? You know? Anyway, they took a break and they got in the back room and they were hugging each other and kissing each other and they were having a toast, scotch and water. I said, wow, Cal knows Jed Clampett. They go, guys, this is Buddy Ebsen, you know? And I said, that's right. That's his real name, Buddy Ebsen. Mm. And I'm just like in awe, like, wow, that's the guy from the Beverly Hillbillies, you know? And then he goes, hey, Cal, let's do our old routine. And I thought, what's that all about? And Cal goes, oh, man, I don't tap no more. And he had, like, rubber shoes on like these.
Yeah.
And he goes, come on, let's do it. And I swear, right in the little back room right there in Redondo Beach, they started giving Cal could tap, man.
Buddy Ebsen was he was in musicals and in the 30s and 40s.
If you think about it, remember he used to come up with Shirley Temple and all those old movies and all that?
Yes.
And I went, holy shit, Buddy Ebsen and Cal Tjader, and they could tap, man.
Crazy.
So,
crazy.
You learn a lot of stuff, man, on the road.
Another guy who was important to you, Clear Fisher.
Oh, God.
He was a composer and an arranger. Tell me about meeting him and how he was helpful to you.
Clare Fisher was great, man. Clare Fisher was a harmonic genius. Mm. That's what he was, man. I mean, the chords he used, beautiful, man.
Yeah.
That guy was a harmonic genius. Well, see, he was in Cal Tjader's band in the 60s. Mm-hmm. I was way too young.
Yeah.
And then he was gone for, 12, 18 years, whatever it was. Then he joined the band when I was in it.
Mm.
So that's how I got to know Clare Fisher.
Mm-hmm.
And when I met him, I know he wrote like Morning and remember Spring.
Pensativa.
Ooh, yeah. I recorded those tunes with him
on
my record. He helped me write tunes. The very first tune I ever wrote in my life is called Baila Mi Gente. I've recorded about four different times now. Baila Mi Gente, Clare Fisher helped me write that tune because I had ideas, but I don't know how to read or write music. Today, I still don't.
Yeah.
But I write my tunes through piano players or trombone players or whatever. Clare helped me write out my ideas and became Baila Mi Gente. And we did a bunch of songs like that together and we got 50-50 on them and all like that.
Sure.
But Clare, man, was such a beautiful guy. I remember we were coming from Tucson to Phoenix. That's only about a 2-hour drive or an hour and 45-minute drive. And we had to rent a car. We were doing gigs with Cal Tjader. And I got the contract from Albert Marks. I don't know, about 10 pages, I have no idea what this is about. And then Clare said, Poncho, you drive to Phoenix, and I'll read you the contract.
Mm.
And I said, oh, thank you. That really helped me out. And so, because he helped me get it, you know what I mean?
Sure.
So I'm driving to Phoenix, and Clare's right there reading all that fine print, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And he goes, Poncho, do you know what that means? And I go, I don't know what that means. So he'd break it down to me, and next page. So by the time I got to Phoenix, Clare read me my whole contract, and said, Poncho, I think it's a good idea to sign with it. I said, I think so too. You know? But he explained everything to me.
Yeah. You did a recording of Dizzy Gillespie and Chano Pazzo tunes.
Yeah.
And I think that was with Terrence Blanchard.
My man Terrence.
Yeah.
T.
Yeah. And I'm wondering, and a terrific album. But the question is, I'm wondering, by doing that album, did it put in your mind that someday I'm gonna take on Coltrane?
Yeah. Sure did.
Yeah. Because when I listen to that record, and now having heard what you did with Coltrane, it's like these are almost, same size, different sides of the same coin.
Yeah, like we mentioned earlier, these are my heroes, man.
Yeah.
And to me, they're the greatest that will ever live. That's how big I think on them.
Yeah.
I even feel I could never be as great as them because these are my heroes.
Yeah.
Dizzy Gillespie, thank God I got to meet Dizzy. I played with Dizzy. He played with Dizzy Gillespie, was a special guest with my band several times. So
tell me about working with him. What Dizzy, was special, man, about working with him?
Oh, Dizzy, man. God only made one of those. Dizzy is the greatest, man. I remember we flew all the way to Sardinia. I mean, I got to my room, and the hotel was kind of nice, you know. I mean, it was all right, you know what I mean? More like a bungalows, you know what I mean? But it was very clean, yeah, and very proper and nice. It was nice, but it wasn't a beautiful hotel, okay? Mm. I was in my hotel room. It was real hot, and I had the windows open, and I'm over there in Italy thinking, like, wow, I'm going to play with – Dizzy's going to play with us. And it was the first day of the tour, first day that we were going to go for almost a month to everywhere, you know? And we're there, and then I hear somebody walking down the hall. You could hear him coming down the hall because it set up kind of more like a bungalow, and it was hard floors.
Yeah.
And I could hear people walking, like three people. So I'm listening, and then I heard Dizzy going, yeah, man. You know, I go, like, you know, that's Dizzy. You know his voice.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Sure. Unmistakable.
That's Dizzy,
yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I said, oh, my God, Dizzy Gillespie was walking down. I mean, I want to open the door and look, but I just listened. And then I thought, oh, my God, they opened the room right next to mine. I said, wow, Dizzy Gillespie going to be in the room next to me? Oh, man, I'll be like this every night, you know, just to see what Dizzy Gillespie does, you know. Well, they come down the hallway, and Dizzy goes, man, it sure is hot. It was one of them hot, muggy summers over there. And then they opened the door, and, man, I'm right by my door just listening. Dizzy just stuck his head in there and looked around, and he said, can I cuss on this thing?
Yes, sir.
Dizzy looked in there, looked around, and he said, can you tell this motherfucker that slavery was over a long time ago? And then they closed the door, and I heard him walk
right
away.
Right back down the hall.
And I went, wow, maybe one day I could be big enough to say something like that, you know? Yeah. And that's just one of the little Dizzy Gillespie stories. I mean, he is one of a kind, yeah, or he was one of a kind.
Yeah. Let's talk about the Coltrane record. You do Blue Trane. You know, which is, you know, from 58, so, you know, relatively early in his recording career, you know, mid. Mm-hmm. And then Liberia and Giant Steps, which is, that's already 1960, and he's moving towards a Love Supreme, you know, at that point.
Circle of Fifths, man.
Yeah, man. I mean, a very pivotal time in his career.
Yeah.
What made you choose those songs? Why was that interesting to you?
Francisco Torres told me about Blue Trane. He goes, mm-hmm, Poncho, Blue Trane would probably be a good idea. I said, oh, of course, everybody's got that record. You know,
right.
I go, oh, that's a great tune, man. It's cool. It's simple, but cool, you know. He said, yeah. He goes, you know what? It lends itself to a cha-cha. Do-do-do-do-do. Dun dun cha cha, you know,
mm-hmm,
or, you know, the original dun 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 dun, but it lends itself to a cha cha, right?
Why take him on now?
Well, actually, I wanted to do it a while back, about three or four records back.
Yeah,
I mean, it was just, you know, for instance, John Burke, you know, I worked with John. Me and John made a lot of records together. I don't know, seven records together, something like that. And we did it from day one to the day it comes out.
Mm-hmm.
John Burke helped me with everything. And before, my musical director at that time was David Torres, who has now passed on, and now Francisco Torres took over that job. John would come to my house and we'd kick around stories and ideas for the next record, you know what I mean? Which, man, I don't know if all the other artists get this, but that's what I get. And that's why I've been with Concord longer than anybody. So John come to my house and Poncho.
The personal.
Yeah, he said, Poncho, what do you want to do next? You know, I go, I don't know. And I got a whole room full of old records and CDs and videos. I'm a collector, so I have stuff from when I was in junior high school in my house, you know. And so I'm putting stuff on for John and stuff that John never even heard. He go, well, I've never heard that before. Well, anyway, we started coming up with ideas of what do you want to do. So actually, I told John about it, I think, about four or five records back.
And
so we're talking over 12 years ago. But we said, well, why don't we do this instead? And then, that sounds like a great idea, you know. And the China Post of Dizzy Gillespie thing, actually, Jim Castle from the Berkeley Agency, who was my manager for like 16, 18 years, he told me about doing the tribute to Dizzy and China Post. And it just... Then he just let it go. We kind of just let it go. And then now my manager, now for the last, I don't know, 8, 9 years, something like that, I don't know, a long time now, Ivory Daniel. Uh-huh. Ivory told me, hey, I remember you told me about you want to do the thing to, for Chano Pozo and a thing for John Coltrane. Why don't we do it? Yeah. So Ivory Daniel is the one that pushed it. Mm-hmm. And that's why that Chano Pozo Dizzy Gillespie came, right. thing came out. And exactly the same thing happened again. Ivory told Poncho, when are you going to do this John Coltrane okay. tribute?
Right.
So when somebody's there, your management or your manager's giving you support to something that you love,
right.
come on. Yeah, it's not going to be too hard to push, okay, stop bending my arm, I'll do it. You know, what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'll go do that.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll go do that.
That's how that happened.
Yeah. That record comes out on the 20th. So last question. You've taken on James Brown's music.
My man.
Booker T and the MGs. We talked about Tower of Power. Yeah. Now John Coltrane. But it's all filtered through your kind of unique approach to Afro-Cuban music. Why is it that you think that approach, and particularly that Afro-Cuban approach, seems to work so well in all these different genres?
Well, all that stuff we just talked about, what you just said, it's in here, my heart, mm-hmm. and it's in here, mm-hmm. in my mind. I've thought of all this for many years, and I'm just getting around to do it all, you know what I mean? I just like it. If there's something on my record, it's because I like it. It's not because somebody told me, you have to put this record on. Yeah. You have to do this song on your record because, you know, that's the latest thing. My records don't have nothing to do with that stuff. Right. It's just, what is Poncho like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I open that up to the band. What is Francisco Torres like? What is, you know, Ron Blake like? And we're like a family, so we start kicking around ideas. And then, like the new record, I told Andy Langham, my piano player, Andy, you know, I need a 6/8 tune, man, for the record. I don't know, come up with something, man, but think about John Coltrane when you're doing it, you know what I mean? And he came up with Subit. Well, actually, he called it Up and Up first. And I go, what is it called? He said, Up and Up. And I go, Up and Up? I said, why don't we call it Sube? He goes, what's that mean? I go, to go up, up and up, Sube. And he goes, I like that.
Yeah, perfect.
So that's how you work it. Yeah. And then on that particular tune, we added all kinds of overdubbed. My friend Cornelius Duncan with that kalimba.
Oh, the kalimba, the thumb piano, whatever it's called.
Yeah. Man, I thought putting that on there, I put the talking drums from Africa, the talking drums on there. I put the kiha, which is the jawbone of a donkey. You hold the kiha, you know, the thing goes, and it echoes, it's a jawbone of a donkey. We added a lot of stuff to that subet tune. But back to the question, all these things that, all these records we mentioned, all the different types of music, I just try to find a way, which I learned from Cal Tjader, to adapt them to what I like and the rhythms I like and like that. Mm. Like the James Brown stuff, Out of Sight, and the stuff we did with Booker T and the MGs, Steve Cropper and Eddie Floyd. We did Raise Your Hand. If there's something you need, you know, where's a cha-cha? It's a funky, but it's a funky cha-cha.
Right.
You know what I mean? That's just like a regular cha-cha-cha.
Yeah, yeah.
Kind of like a little funk in there, you know what I mean? And so I just like to adapt the music I like and the music I grew up with to come out with this.
Well, all I can tell you is we're glad you're still doing it because it's fantastic. Poncho Sanchez, thank you so much for being on
Prestige
70
Good to see you again, man.
You bet, man.
All right,
absolutely.
Thank you.